Can anybody hear me?
Yep.
Hello?
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Matt Geroud.
No, I got it.
Martin Folan's work here at the Sailor's House. My name is Mick O'Dea, and it's an honour for me to have been asked to say a few words before the opening tonight. It's my first time ever opening an exhibition where everyone's been cleared out of the art gallery. But I mean, it's a beautiful evening anyway, and I know that many of you knew Martin Wells. All of you knew him one way or another, some of you knew him very, very well. I think around this time last year that Martin came to Brian McMahon's exhibition retrospective.
Yeah.
And I wasn't at it myself, unfortunately, I missed it, but little did we know that he was saying goodbye to everybody that night. And so many people that I've met said he looked great. He made it his business to go around and say hello to everybody, and he made a big effort to come out, and again, I'm told that it was an evening just like this evening. It's hard to fathom that he's dead a year now. It's also kind of, I'm mixed kind of feelings about, I'm quite sad, upset, but the year has gone by, and a lot of us have been able to kind of process that. Also heartened and kind of delighted to see his work inside. And I mean, credit goes to Maraid and the two guys, Martin, James, Martin Shannon, James Collins, who hung the show, Marina, and Cleo, Martin's stepdaughter. And we've kind of just done an amazing job in presenting it, and it's the perfect venue for the work. I knew Martin from NCAD. I was a student with him. Martin was from Finglas. He was in the sculpture department. I started off in the sculpture department, then moved into the painting department. He had an amazing ability to people gravitated towards him. And he was genuinely curious. I had said before that in the 70s in our college, particularly late 70s, it was polarized. The media that you were working in seemed to be the message rather than the message, regardless of the media. So that if you were a painter, you were condemned to be in a particular kind of position, and if you're a performance artist, you were in another kind of an area, and people kind of mapped out their spheres. Martin was never kind of bound by the media being the message. The message was what was important to him, and he tended to therefore cross all the kind of prejudices that were very much in place, ridiculously so in retrospect, at that time. During the ceremony officiated by Marina last year, Chris McGuire talked, and Chris was a colleague of mine as well in college with Martin, talked about being in the sculpture yard with Martin, and the next thing, a sparrow fell from the sky. Some of you will have heard this story. Sparrow landed in the sculpture yard, and Martin picked it up, and he was so moved just by this creature that he he organised a funeral with a hearse, with the attendants, the full shebang, and the most insignificant of creatures, or what seemed to be the most insignificant of creatures, was something that just triggered a whole amazing response in Martin that took on, you know, they suddenly the Undertakers were involved and took it very seriously. The funeral party took it all very seriously, and everyone felt, and unfortunately I wasn't at it, but everyone felt that I've met really, they were part of something extraordinarily special. Martin had the ability to cast that kind of net and draw people in. I also, you know, remember him very well in his kind of studio garage, Waldron's, at the top of Moore Street on Parnell Street. It was kind of an Art Deco 1930s, 1940s petrol station come garage. And which suited Martin's work, because he wouldn't necessarily be stimulated by the aged patination of old Georgian buildings. His influences seemed to come more from the media, from responding to songs that were coming out on the radio, from just hearing current affairs stuff. And I mean, just I'm taken back to Colonel North, if you all remember Colonel North, and in Nicaragua, and the Contras, and words, and that work is reflected on the wall where there's North, and he might play South, and but it triggered things. But his inspiration came from current affairs, from music, from technology. He was aware of the power of television ever before, kind of, and subsequently, obviously, by the range of media that we have. But that was his inspiration. At the same time, he kind of could understand someone painting a landscape, and he even has a piece in cut-out lettering, landscape painting. He also, I suppose, because he was so he absorbed the media and the messages, he found media that kind of corresponded to the influences he was absorbing. Polyester, I suppose we called it Aeroboard. We were looking at Martin's Aeroboard works. I don't think I've ever seen any other artist work with Aeroboard like he did. Plywood, a lot of spontaneous ideas coming, but to make the images, you have to be so deliberate. You have to plan it out. His spontaneity came from really absorbing, from being clear, and from then working out what appears to be spontaneous images, but are so well crafted, so well designed, and so innovative. He didn't go for maybe traditional oil paint, a la palette stuff, but he did use household paints, be it matte or high gloss. He kept his palettes pretty kind of strong, black, red, and yellows, whites, they come across, but he plays around as well. I mean, he was a great student of art history, and when you look at many of the works, I mean, he's absorbed the lessons of American art from the 1960s, whether it was Rauschenberg or just the pop art, that's very much there. And in fact, I think that Martin really found his feet when he was in America, and we were all so proud of him. And Marina was with him on that journey when he got the P.S.1, the first Irish artist to get the P.S.1 scholarship to New York, and he worked there. Remember one of the stories, and Marina and I were reminiscing about it earlier on, when at the end of his residency, he had this amazing piece inspired by "When You're Alone and You're Feeling," and there was a piece there. The words were kind of cut out, and it was a ladder that went right up with amazing colours. And this lady came in. He didn't know who she was, but she said, and it was great. You don't get this here necessarily. An artist loves to hear this. She said, "I like it. I want it. How much?" Perfect. You know, it reminds me, like, what's the best compliment you could pay an artist? A check. Moving on from that, he sold it. He was just, I think, amazed. It was such an amazing piece of work. But he asked for $200, which was a considerable amount of money. But somebody came up to him afterwards and told him her name. She was Princess something or other, one of the richest women in the world, who wouldn't have batted an eyelid if he had said 2,000 and maybe even 20,000. But she snapped it up anyway, you know. He came back to Ireland with Mairead, and he came to Limerick. And I remember his first studio was in Walnut House, if I'm not mistaken, with Tom Short and Mairead, and Tom he knew from NCAD. I worked on several projects with him. I have a show recently of work that I did with Travellers via Pave Point. And a huge part of Martin's contribution to the arts and to the community in Ireland, and particularly in Limerick, was his work with communities and with different groups, whether it was literacy schemes or just even his contribution to the St. Patrick's Day parade, where he made it such an exciting event and where he just changed the kind of level that one could expect from the from communities working in the public realm. And it reminded me of my participation with many other artists in similar types of performances that he had in Dublin on O'Connell Street one particular evening. He managed to locate a really, at the time, an exotic American vehicle for a vehicle recovery with full of lights that were going kind of bling. That went down O'Connell Street with about 20 of us all dressed in white suits with these outlandish aeroboard rifles. At about 11 o'clock in the night, revelers were kind of getting all excited. They were thinking, is there a coup going on? What's going on here, you know? There was coups going on all over the world, and it was consistent with the work that he was doing as well. Gardaí were kind of hesitant about coming out because there was too many of us with our aeroboard rifles. And so we kind of cut a passage along O'Connell Street, over O'Connell Bridge, and up through Trinity College and finished up at the archway above in St. Stephen's Green, and then dispersed. And there wasn't a coup or there wasn't a revolution, even though by then a lot of vehicles had gathered in the vicinity. But we're here today. I won't, Rough Diamond, that's the kind of name for the show, but we all know that it's a great cover name, and we know that within that rough diamond there was a gem. And Martin Folan was a gem of a man.
Yes.
He's touched us in so many ways. His contribution to Limerick, to the artists, to the people he has met is phenomenal. He's changed people's lives for the better. And his loss is huge.
Sad,
yeah. Thanks for the words. So, anyway, his art is of the highest level. This is a fantastic show of museum quality art that represents a particular period in Irish creativity, and creativity in production by a singular outstanding artist who worked amongst us in the 70s, 80s and 90s. And we're privileged to be able to get a look at some of that production here behind us in the Sailor's House tonight. So thank you all for coming. And again, like I said, it's been a great pleasure to say a few words. For now.
I'm Marina Byrne Folan, and I am Martin Folan's daughter. I'm here just to say a few thank yous. The first thank you is to Mick O.D. for opening the show for us. Thank you so much, Mick. I appreciate it.
Very kind.
Okay.
These are the people that are in mass.
I was inviting everyone out, but they're fine. The first group of people I would like to thank is everyone who's here tonight. I want to thank family, friends, artists, community members, and people representing organizations, galleries, and museums in the city. I have actually never been at an art opening that I can remember. I'm a math teacher, so this is very, very new for me, and I appreciate the warmth and that you're sharing this experience with me, especially as it is my father's work. The second group of people I would like to thank are people who helped with the printing of the amazing posters that I'm sure many of you have seen around the city. for this show. I want to thank Pat Beasley, Pamela Dunn, and Des McMahon, as well as Bob Corrigan, for all their hard work with those blue posters designed by Martin Shannon. I also want to thank the people down at Limerick Self Storage. If you are looking to store anything, it's an amazing organization right around the corner. Specifically Martin, who works there and organizes everything, and also Mike, who helped us transport things up, although he does not work there. I would also like to thank the Shannon Points Port Authority, who are in charge of this building, the Sailor's Home, and specifically Tom Tracy, our liaison, and the Night Watchman, who locked us out every single evening and then allowed us back in the morning. I would like to thank the Hunt Museum, the Limerick City Gallery, and the University of Limerick Visual Arts Department for their support and enthusiasm in the weeks leading up to this show, and for letting me know that they would definitely be here tonight. I appreciate your attendance and interest. I would also like to thank, I'm halfway done, I would like to thank Mike Fitz and Sheila Deegan for supporting throughout the last few weeks with promotion especially. They also provided most of the wine. So big thank you to Sheila Deegan and Mike Fitz for organizing that. There are a few people who supported my father, there are many people who supported my father throughout his life and have continued to play a vital role in the last year, I guess, at this point, in keeping his artistic spirit alive. So I want to thank Randall Hodgkinson and Lucy Medlicott for their work in keeping his spirit alive over the last year. And I'm just gonna apologize now because I know I will forget people. I put this list together very quickly right before the show, so please know that my appreciation is abundant, and if I don't mention your name, I very, very much appreciate everything you've done to support this show as well as my father in general. The last group I would like to thank are the people who have been here on the ground working to put this show up over the last few days. Angus McGee, Jordana Jacquet, I'm sorry if I pronounced it wrong, Jordana. James Ryan, Hallie Morrison, and a very, very, very big thank you to Martin Shannon, who has just, I cannot describe how instrumental he has been in putting this show together and preserving the art, making decisions over the whole year. So thank you to Martin Shannon especially. And then also thank you, I'm speaking on behalf of my mother and sister, Marie Byrne and Cleo Byrne Gooding, but I also want to thank them for their endless support, and especially to my mother for pushing me to do a show, because as I said, this is not my zone of comfort, this is very different for me. And in that thread, I also want to thank all the artists in Limerick for just welcoming me with open arms and teaching me how to hang things and what it means to balance a room or offer something to a wall. All of this, thank you so, so much. And then finally, I want to thank the artist. I want to thank Martin Folan for providing such amazing work and being so creative and pushing the envelope. I think he was far ahead of his time. So I want to thank him. And with that, again, thank you to anyone whose name I did not say. I do appreciate everything you've done. We have one more speaker, Steve Lally. He's going to tell a story. Oh, I said James, did I not?
Jordana said, I thought you did too.
Say it again.
And James Ryan, I thought I said it. I'm sorry. All right, and with that, Steve Lally.
Thank you very much.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hi.
Right. Put this here for a second, and I take this coat off.
Well, good evening, everybody, and what a great event to be at. I knew Mark when I was in college at the Limerick College of Art. Martin was really good to me, and a great encouragement. He was a great man for telling stories, you know. It must have rubbed off because I eventually became a professional storyteller. So I'm here to tell you a story, and I was thinking, what sort of a story would Martin like, you know? And I knew Martin, he was a larger-than-life character, so I'd have to tell a story about another larger-than-life character. But before we do that, can anyone tell me, what do you say at the start of a story? I'm sure that somebody, what do you say at the start of a story?
Long, long ago.
You're a genius. I thought we'd be here all day. Very good. Right. But I can't tell the story without your help. And you can't hear the story without my help. So, can everybody point at themselves like this?
Oh, very good.
And in a big loud voice, can everyone say, it wasn't in my time.
It wasn't in my time.
Point to the person next to you, don't poke them in the eye, and say, it wasn't in your time.
It wasn't in your time.
And hold out your arms in front of you as lovingly as you can and say, it wasn't in your mammy's time.
It wasn't in your mammy's time.
And put your hands on your hips, proud but not arrogant. And can we all say, it wasn't in your grandfather's time.
It wasn't in your grandfather's time.
And now we're going to put your arms in the air. And can we all say, but it was a good time. And all the houses were touched with pancakes. And the walls were made of penny loaves. And those walls were whitewashed with buttermilk. And outside, the little pigs ran around with a knife and a fork stuck in their backsides, going, eat me, eat me, eat me. Now, the story I'm going to tell you is a story from a long, long time ago. And it came from a place called Greece, ancient Greece. Oh, yes, yes, yes. And the Greeks were famous for many things. They're mathematicians, they're storytellers, and they're philosophers. Anyone know what a philosopher is? Yes, yourself, that's right. Someone who thinks they know everything about everything. Now, and usually has the answer before you even ask the question. Now, right. Now, there was a great philosopher who wrote this story, the story I'm going to tell you. The story was called The Odyssey. Now, now let's just assume everyone doesn't know who wrote The Odyssey. Hands up who doesn't know who wrote The Odyssey. Oh, about 2 years. Right, okay. Well, I just do, this is what I do with the kids when I'm working them in the schools and stuff. I say, does anybody here watch The Simpsons? Yeah. Oh, very good. So I'm going to ask you that question, and I'm going to get everyone to shout out the first name, just the first name of the daddy from The Simpsons. Who wrote The Odyssey?
Homer.
Ah, you knew your classics. Very good, very good, very good. Right, now. Well, he had a friend, and his friend, well, he was another great philosopher. Anyone know any name of any other Greek philosophers?
Socrates,
very good.
Aristotle.
Aristotle, where's me bottle? Very good. Now, Aristotle, he used to say, everyone repeat after me, every young person,
should know the name
and the nature
of everything.
That ran. And everything.
That flew.
Anyone come behind me, no?
And everything.
That swam.
And everything.
That grew.
Now, we're going to step back in time to ancient Greece. And we are upon a great Greek galleon. And we are all rowing our boat together. So can everyone grab yours and all go,
heave-ho.
Now I need some helpers for this part. Now there's a boy there who's going to help me. Come on up here, give him a big round of applause. And there's two girls there, I can see them. Oh yes, two over here, we're only supposed to. We're walking the plank here. Right, here, come on up. That's it. Yo!
No.
I have something here that's... Right.
Have I just gone off? Have I? Just gone off.
Okay.
Oh, sorry. What have you done with the sound?
Okay, you hold there.
You turn the mic on. You might want to leave it on next time.
You come around this side.
Okay, guys, hold the didgeridoo out in front of you. Hold it out in front of you, like this. And then pull it in. And then out, and in. And now can everyone go, heave-ho! Go on. Heave-ho! Heave-ho! That's it, keep her in. Bring her round, boys. Let her down, boys, and we'll sail home to Mandalay. Give them a big round of applause. Well done. Very good. Right, now, disappear. Okay, now. Well, brave Odysseus, king of Ithaca, had been on his ship, and they'd been sailing for many days and many nights. And they hadn't found dry land for a long time, and the sailors began to grumble. Let's hear your grumble.
Oh, very good, very good, very good. Now, he needed to find land. And in those days, they had no maps, because the maps were rubbish, because they thought the earth was flat. They had no sat-navs, and they had no compasses. Does anyone know how they found their way? Do any of the children know? How do you know?
Stars.
Oh, yeah, that's right, the North Star.
Holy smokes.
Right. Anyway, he looked up at the North Star, and he said, we'll go west, and west they went. Now, I need a lookout. There's that man again with the leather jacket. Come on up here. Right, what's your name?
Daniel.
Right, Daniel, today you are Hercules, the strongest man in ancient Greece. Okay, Hercules, now I want you to climb up there into the crow's nest. No, climb up. No, that's Lady Gaga. No, I want you to jump up there now. Go on, jump up into the crow. No, you're coming back down again. That's no good. You have to stay up there. Right, go on, up you go. Ah, for goodness sake. Right, okay, we're all going to count to three, and Hercules is going to stay up there. One, two, three! No, you're back down again. Okay, we'll try it again. We'll all count to three, and we'll shout stop, and surely to goodness he'll stay up there. One, two, three, stop! Right, Hercules, listen, see when you go home this evening, will you tell your mammy to bring you to the doctor? You've got the worst case of gravity you've ever seen. Give a big round of applause. Well done. Hold on. You're not going anywhere. Now, this is your telescope, so you look through that. Now, I need another helper. I want the children. Oh, this girl here. Come on up here. Now, you hold that. Now, Hercules, right? I want you to look through that. And in a big, loud voice, can you say, I see land.
I see land.
Hello, is your name Hercules? Right, say that again. Hercules. I see land.
Hello, I see land.
And then can the rest of you say, where?
Where?
And this wee girl, what's your name? Well, we're going to say you're Helen of Troy. Helen of Troy, can you say, there?
There!
And everyone go, where?
Where?
There!
Oh, let me have a look. Hold on a second. Hold on now. No, that's your man's head. No. We're not all going to fit on there. But it was a good try anyway. Well, anyway, they went onto the island and they found some fresh water and food and they were very happy. But then a terrible storm brewed up. Can we make lots of sound like a big storm? Come on. Yo, that's it. Oh, lovely. So they had to find some shelter. Now, here, have a look through your telescope there. Yes. And can you say, I see a cave. Hello, any time today?
I see a cave.
Where?
Hold on, let me have a look. No, that's not a cave. That's the big fella's mouth over there now. We're not all going to fit in there, but a good try. Well, they went inside the cave, and they lit a fire, and they were very, very happy. Well, it was only until they heard the sound of giant footsteps coming. They'll go, one, two, one, two, that's it. And then the sailors started shaking with fear. Can I see us all shaking with fear? And then a big giant looked inside. He had a huge big eye in the middle of his forehead. He looked down and he walked inside and he pushed a rock in front of the mouth of the cave. All the sailors were trapped inside. And he went in and he says, Eeny, meeny, miny, mo. Catch a sailor by the toe. If he squeals, I don't know. Who should I pick? Who wants to be picked for the next part? Oh, yourself! Oh, no, listen, I'm just going to give you a very valuable lesson that'll stand to you for the rest of your days, right? Do you see, when you agree to do something, right, always find out what it is first, okay? You've just put yourself forward as the giant's dinner, but that's fine. I'm sorry, what's your name?
Marion.
Well, now, the giant picked up Marion and was about to pop Marion into his mouth, but Marion came well prepared. She hadn't changed her socks in over 8 weeks. And when the giant smelled them, he went, woo-woo, and dropped her on the ground, and she was safe, and all the sailors gave a big cheer. But Odysseus saw what was happening. He says, oh, we're in trouble here. This boy's going to ace us all. So he had to come up with a plan. He went over to the giant and he said, hello, Mr. Giant. What did the giant say?
Good day.
Oh, yeah, very good. He says, what's your name? And the giant says, I asked the questions around here. What's your name? And Odysseus, who was very clever, he said, my name is Nobody. Well, the giant thought this is very funny. He said, well, Nobody, I like you so much, I'll leave you to last for dessert. Well, with that, he had to come up with a plan to get the giant to go asleep. Now,
Can we get some more helpers? Can we get some of your wee friends up? Can we get some of the children up? Come on up here. Come on. Yes, come on up here. Good man. And this girl here, come on up. Lovely, lovely, lovely. Yes. Now, okay, guys, right, we're going to sing a song, okay, to put the giant to sleep. You all know the words. It goes, twinkle, twinkle. Do you know that one? Okay, all together.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star. Very good, like angels.
Up above the... Like a...
Diamond in the sky.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star. How I wonder what you are. Now everyone repeat after me. Twinkle, twinkle.
Twinkle, twinkle.
Little star.
Little star.
We know exactly what you are. A floating, flying.
Floating
rubbish bin.
Rubbish
bin. A piece of old.
Piece of old.
Rusted tin.
Rusted tin.
And this is a poem.
This is a poem.
By Spike Milligan. Well now, anyway, the giant was fast asleep and the sailor says, that's all well and good, he's asleep, but when he wakes up and finds out we tricked him, he's going to ate us all. What are we going to do? And Odysseus says, don't worry, I've got a brilliant plan. So the giant, the soldiers, took out their swords.
And they began to sharpen the stick. Go on, sharpen the stick.
And they lifted the stick in the air and they began to count as they lifted the stick above his eyes. We're all going to count in ancient Greek. Go on, you start counting there first.
One. Come on, try it there.
Yeah. I know I'm going to have to teach you how to count in ancient Greek. Now everyone repeat after me. One-ery. Two-ery. Dickery. Dabbery. Hallyboo crack. And Henry Navery. Discum-dum. Mary come rhyme. Ramblin' bamblin'. In the eye. Well, they brought the stick down to the, into the monster's eye, and he let a terrible roar out of him. Come on now. Oh, louder than that. Come on now. And again. Very good, very good. And he pushed the rock away from the cave. He ran out. He was roaring the head off himself. And his brothers came and says, brother, brother, what's wrong with you? What are you roaring and shouting like that for? He says, there's something stuck in my eye. I said, who did that to you? He says, nobody. They said, what? Who did that to you? Nobody. Ah, you big Egypt. They said, you must have fallen, dropped something into your eye. We'll get a tweezers and we'll have it out in a jiffy. In the meantime, the sailors crept out of the terrible cave and hopped on the ship and grabbed the oars. Are you ready? Okay. Get in there now. And here, all together. Yeah, get in there. That's it. And all together. Heave ho!
Heave ho! Heave-ho.
Bring her round, boys. Let her down, boys. And we'll sail home to Mandalay. Yo, well now, let's give them a big cheer. Well done. To know you can sit down. And as the ship sailed away, Odysseus, who was a very arrogant man, he turned round to the giant, who was known as Polyphemus the Cyclops. He said, Cyclops, it was not nobody who did this to you, it was me, Odysseus, king of Ithaca, sacker of Troy. The giant was so angry, he picked up a rock and he threw it at them. Splash! And another one! And another one! Well, luckily for Odysseus and his men, the rocks missed them. But those rocks are still there to this very day. And if you look at a map of Greece, you will see little islands all around Greece. We call them the Greek islands. The people of Greece call them the Cyclops Islands. And there are places all over the world named after old stories like that. And one of the most famous ones is up there near where I'm living in the north of Ireland. Does anyone know what that one's called? You're a genius. Well done. Well, listen, thank you all very much. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
The majority of the work is for sale, and prices are posted in the middle hallway. If you are interested in anything, you can talk to me or my mother, Mairead Byrne. But welcome and thank you for being here.
Thank you.
you can still remember. Thank you. Sing